This is the second video in the platform bed build, and we've added a little bit more, which we're going to talk about today. But if I were to take this and put it in my son's room right now and put his mattress on it, it's still a bed on a floor.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, sponsored by Lee Valley and Veritas. With over 5,000 high-quality woodworking hand tools, visit their online catalog at leevalley.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. As you can see, we have definitely made progress on the platform bed build. We now have this nice box that is enclosing and will hide the majority of the undercarriage itself. And we just have some really beautiful maple. I can't wait to get this going. In fact, there's a little bit of figure, not much on the front there, but since this is going to be kind of tucked away underneath the main platform itself, you probably won't see it too much. Of course, now that I say that, you'll probably see it a lot. Anyways, though, with today's episode, we're going to concentrate on how we assembled the box itself. Now, when it comes to resawing the material, which I resawed it from the 8-quarter, perhaps you heard me talk about this over at Wood Talk or one of the postings on our Facebook page. In fact, perhaps you even saw the video where I was resawing this material because I mentioned that my current resaw blade was way too dull to be able to handle this material. In fact, what it ended up doing was veering off during the cut. It had nothing to do with the tension or the guide blocks. It had everything to do with the blade being really, really dull. So in the meantime, I found a really great carbide tipped blade that I completely forgot about. I don't know how you forget about something like that, but I was able to put that on. And while it's not the same size as my ordinary resaw blade, it did a fantastic job of getting through this. In fact, if you saw the video of it at Facebook, I'm gonna invite you to head over there and check that out. I had a lot of fun with it. I was so excited that it worked. Anyways though, so what we did is we got this material down to about 7/8 of an inch, and then we came in, and the original design was gonna call for half blind dovetails at the front and the back. This is the reason why I did not release the SketchUp plan for this yet, is because I decided to alter it. And part of the reason I decided to alter it is because I made a mistake, to be quite honest with you. There's no reason to hide the wart on this one. I started to make the cut and it suddenly dawned on me, oh, these are supposed to be half blind. And I hate doing through dovetails because I don't feel comfortable with it, but I did it anyway. So I did it all by hand. And as a result of that, we have some footage for it, just a few clips here of the actual cutting of the dovetails themselves. So let's go ahead and take a look at that footage, because with the size of these boards, this one particularly here, the size comes in at like 73.5 inches, and then the front here again about 53 inches or so. It's not something I can simply put in my vise and stand up, but let's take a look at that footage and we'll talk more about it. So to cut these dovetails, I have the board laying flat against the bench, and I am going to come in with my saw inverted and actually attempt to make the dovetails themselves. Now, I saw this technique on the Tommy McDonald's rough cut show. It was he visited a woodworker that had this really neat technique where he was inverting his saw. I'm hoping it's going to work out. If I had done it my other way, my hand would kind of be like up here trying to cut them, or I could be up on a stool or something to do it. But I figured, what the heck, we got nothing to lose, and maybe we'll learn a new technique. One thing I am going to do is, I've got everything laid out here, I'm going to give myself a little bit of a shortcut by creating kind of like a V-groove for a notch for my saw to fit into. So I'm just going to take my chisel here and kind of cut out a little V-groove, a little bird's mouth, if you will, to kind of help get things started. All right, and then once we do this first one, I'll make sure to bring the camera around as we do these others so we can get a better look at it. So here hopefully goes something. There we go. Oh, I think the problem is I'm just gripping way too hard on it. All right. Maybe I should try this first. There we go. I'm thinking I might need to clamp this down just a little bit more. All right, well, this isn't quite working out the way I thought it would. So maybe we will just simply come in this way. We gave it a good shot. I really want to get moving on this, so we'll do this. Thank you. I'm at that line and we're good on that side. All right, so we've got that. I guess I found another technique that I'm gonna try. So I'll go ahead and I'll bring it around. We'll take a look at this. I was really hoping I could get that other technique to work, but obviously, not so much. So let's just continue doing this and we'll go from there. All right, so. One thing I did have to do is I have a clamp right over here to help hold this down, and that seems to be making a big difference too. All right, almost there. We just have this last one to do, and this first set is all done. So we have everything cut here, the curves. Now we want to remove this waste material. So we got it up on edge, clamped in position. And again, I'm going to give myself a nice reference. I already marked it with a knife. But now I want to, again, give myself that little bit of a kerf, a little bird's mouth. This is way more than I actually need to do. But it'll give my saw something to slide down into. All right. And hopefully give us a nice square line. But we're going to try and leave a little bit of material so we can pare down to it. Then we can just clean up those knife marks. All right, so we have both of the shoulders cut, and I haven't cleaned those up yet because I want to remove this middle material. And to do that, I am going to use the chisel that comes to the closest width here at the base, and that happens to be my half inch chisel. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and stay just ahead of the line, and then when I chop, what will end up happening is the chisel will kind of bump backwards and hopefully go towards that slot. It's okay if I leave some of the material where it is. So let's do this. And I'm gonna chop halfway through, flip the board, and then continue chopping even further. So let's kind of get started here. And yeah, we can go just a little bit deeper. All right. I can come forward just a pinch. I'll break that out. All right. Break some more. All right, and one nice thing about coming forward just ahead of that line is you can see that I'm pulling backwards to pop that out. And by doing that, I'm not messing up that line. I'm not messing up the shoulder here. It leaves a little buffer room. So in this case, I don't think I'm going to flip it over. I'm just going to keep on going. I haven't had this kind of good success in a long time. So let's. There. All right. Now we'll flip it over because I don't want it to tear out on the other side. So loosen. All right, so we're now on the opposite side, and you can see that keeping it away from the line. There we go. And there it is, all chopped out. I just need to kind of clean up the shoulder and go from there. All right, so we have our tails done, and I'm going to have to tell you, this is another one of those things why I didn't release the SketchUp plan any earlier. I've changed my mind on doing half-blind dovetails like I was originally planning, and I'm going to do full through dovetails, which has me a little nervous because I don't do them a lot. But I think in this situation, they'll look really nice. So anyways, let's go ahead and get everything lined up here. Again, because of the size of this, this is not how I ordinarily would mark things. Another thing I'm going to change is normally I would go to, say, my marking knife, But this time I'm just going to scribe everything in with a pencil. And the main thing is not to have this fall down, which it has done a couple of times as I'm trying to do this. So anyways, let's go ahead and let's get that pencil line drawn in, keeping everything marked exactly where we want it. And then we can always come back with the marking knife and clean up those edges, or excuse me, scribe those lines a lot better. All right, so that's a good start. All right, let's move that out of the way. Okay, we can see, hopefully I'll come in here, get a close up, the lines that we have. And like I said, we'll just use the marking knife to put a nice little cut in there. And then we'll use the dovetail saw. And again, we'll probably have to get down on our knees and do it. And the goal will be to stay with inside those pencil lines. And the last one. See that, hopefully you can see I've got some pencil lines here, and that should give us a nice tight fit that we can clean. Okay, so we've got our lines here, and again, just like last time, we're gonna take our widest chisel, which in this case, I can get my 1 inch in here, and it looks like I have a little extra room. We're gonna break away from, or we're gonna chop down just in front of this line, so then that way when we break that waist, it isn't gonna mess up the shoulder line. We'll go as deep as possible on one side, do both of them, and then we'll flip it over and do the other. So let's go ahead and get started. Another thing you notice is I'm starting on the narrowest side here, and that should be good. This time I'm going to come in this way. All right. Go down a little bit deeper. One thing I could have done is I could have made a series of cuts in here, and that would help to make chopping this huge thing out a lot easier, but then I wouldn't have to hit as hard. Okay, so that's good for this side. And then what we'll do is we'll flip it over and do it from the other side. So I'm gonna continue on this. And then I'll come back when we flip it over. Okay, you can see that I removed most of that material. This is the show face, so again, I'm going to stay just ahead of that line. Dropping this down, it'll chatter back. Also, I want to stay clear of the shoulder so that it looks nice. Carefully. All right. All right. So we are through. I'll chop this one out. We just need to clean this up a little bit, which I'm going to grab. And just to kind of give you an idea of what we're doing here, there we go. And what I really want to do is I'll kind of create a little bit of a V groove going in this way and then coming from the other direction so that this very center is a little bit narrower or is a little bit deeper. Not much, but it'll just kind of give me a little clearance room. Anyways, though, so this is almost done. So I'll chop this and then we'll do a test fit. All right, and here's that final result. So I got to stop knocking myself down about these. Of course, I have three other sets to make. It does look like there's some gaps in here, but it's actually because of the pencil marks. So once we get this in place and we clean up this edge, it will look a little bit nicer. And if there are any gaps, I got a neat little trick, which we'll take care of as it gets closer to the finishing process. One thing, and I'll try and bring the camera around here so you can see it, but on the back side, I still have a little bit of cleaning up at the very bottom of the pins themselves so that this will get in there nice and snug and all set. But this is pretty much taken care of. Like I said, I have three more to do, and then this box is all set. And here's the result of that work. Turned out fantastic. In fact, as I mentioned, originally they were supposed to be half-blind dovetails, but apparently the design decided it wanted full-on through. Now, I have to admit, these have turned out way better than I ever thought they would. And I know I need to stop saying how bad my workmanship is, but when it comes to something like this, I always get really nervous about it, but I'm very happy with it. As we look at the kind of the close-ups here, it looks like there, like I mentioned, there is the gappiness. There's one or two of them that have a little bit more gappiness in it. But I think once we get everything flushed up and these pencil marks get removed, it will help to make it look so much nicer. And if the gaps still do stay there, there are some ways to fix that, and we'll get to that when that time comes around. In fact, actually on the back side there, which will be where the headboard is, which will be up against the wall, so I'm not too worried about it. I did have a blowout during a test fit of it. The nice thing is the blowout was able to just fall to the side, so I grabbed that little chunk and we'll fix that right along with it. So without my pointing it out, you probably would have never even known about it, hopefully, unless you really paid close attention to it. Anyways, one nice thing when it comes to these dovetails, regardless of whether they're half blind or through, is that they help to self-square the carcass itself of whatever it is you're building. And that is really crucial with this. So I'm very, very happy with it. And it really helps out. In fact, when I took the square around and did all those other type of checking for square, they were pretty much dead on. So I was very happy about that. One thing I want to do is I'm going to turn this to the side and we'll reset the camera up. I want to talk a little bit about how we're going to put the undercarriage into this bed frame, and then we'll wrap up this video and we'll just go from there. So let me rearrange this and bring the camera around. Now, the way I plan to install the undercarriage to the box itself is because these are long grain to long grain joints, even though they're kind of coming in something like this, they're not right alongside of each other, it's still long grain to long grain joint, I'll just simply do a glue line here and that's it. That's all there is. Now, the same thing when it goes along the ends here, again, the materials will be running in the same exact length, so we'll do the same thing there. A concern a lot of people may be having is, oh, what are you going to do for wood movement, especially because of the lap joint itself, the way that it comes together. Well, a happy, pleasant little accident, perhaps, maybe shrewd design, I don't know, but we have a nice little gap here at the lap joint itself. And the neat thing about it is, let me grab my phone here. One of the things I did, and I might have mentioned this before, is I checked with the wood shop widget and I looked at the wood movement on here, and I know that this material is coming in about 8%. This is the peak season of humidity here in Michigan, so at the most it's going to then shrink down. So at the most, when it shrinks and expands, it's going to be about 1/32nd of an inch for this type of material, and it turns out that I've got a little 1/32nd of an inch play at either end. Actually, it's a little bit more like 1/16th of an inch. So that totally works out. Maybe that was, again, a bad design. I don't know. Bad cuts. But it works out perfectly fine. So the way that we're going to put the lap joints together, the corner laps here, is we'll probably just simply use some sort of dowel and we'll glue it in those couple of spots. We'll maybe have a diagonal of glue or something because that's not going to be a main area. The purpose of that lap joint was just, I wanted to cut it really cool, and it does actually provide some strength, but it's going to totally work out for that, for the wood movement. So we've got all of that taken care of, not concerned about it whatsoever, now that I know for a fact that it's taken care of. Let me turn the camera around. We'll take a look at the backside because I just want to talk about what's coming up next for the next portion of the build, which is going to be the feet. And we'll actually give us a chance to look at the underside of the undercarriage and talk a little bit more about how we're going to attach it and support it. All right, so real quickly, here we are under the undercarriage. So this is the undercarriage. And the way that we're gonna end up supporting this is, in the plan, of course, we have two more supports that are gonna go here to add, again, just a little extra rigidity, a little extra support. They'll probably just get put in with pocket holes, is what I'm thinking, pocket hole screws, because they're not really super uber important. When it comes to attachment here into the front, again, we have that nice long grain to long grain joint, but I'm just gonna put like a little glue block right in this area that will run in the same direction as the grain here. So I don't have to worry about expansion and contraction on it. The corners, which are gonna be rather kind of crucial if you think about it, when the legs get put in place, they'll help to support it. I thought about putting glue blocks here, but because I have these pieces here, I don't really need it, but because I get paranoid, I probably will put at least one or two along the edge here to add that extra rigid support. And that's really all there is to this. The next thing we're gonna be working on are those feet. That's the big one I wanna move on to. And that will actually take care of this whole box. And the undercarriage portion will be done. We can then move on to the platform itself and, of course, the headboard, and then it'll be finished. And we'll finally get my son's mattress up off of the floor. All right, folks, that's pretty much going to do it then. If you have comments, questions, suggestions, you know how to get a hold of me, mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or you can stop by the website. Leave a comment in today's show notes at mattsbasementworkshop.com. If you're watching this over at YouTube, leave a comment over there. I love hearing from all of you. And, of course, we have a little bit more to do on this. The feet are definitely coming up next, and that should be a lot of fun because we're doing some tapering. Yay, tapering. But anyways, though, until the next episode, I will be talking to all of you soon. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. To find even more videos and woodworking-related content, be sure to visit our website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Google+. And don't forget to subscribe to the show either on YouTube, in iTunes, or you can even receive email notifications whenever we post something new.